started. The annihilation of caste is written in December 1939.
Hizli concentration camp. We visited this place with Dr. Anand Teltumbde. You can trace the history of India from this place, the real history of freedom, of a struggle which never stopped since Aryan invasion, the Negroid people, it's the human escape of Jungle Mahal and Central India, which is rural India again, aborigine and indigenous who never subordinated themselves to foreign rule. And they continued their fight. And Hizli concentration camp is converted into IIT Kharagpur, the number one education and professional institute of India. And our friend Dr. Anand Teltumbde is a professor in IIT Kharagpur, and he guided us to Hizli concentration camp. Me and Savita, we came right from Digha, and Rama Teltumbde, the granddaughter of Baba Sahab Dr. Ambedkar, the daughter of Yashwant Ambedkar, hosted us. And it is the place where the rebels of Chuar, we have got the one panel about the Karnagar queen, Rani Shiromani. And Karnagar is very important. I talked to Dhananjay Murmu from Bakura district, who in Jungle Mahal and Jharkhand celebrate the Mahishasur Utsav. From Vedic literature and history of Bengal, we know that people residing in Jungle Mahal across the borders of Bengal, Jharkhand, Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh and Andhra, Dandakaran, they were called Asur. It was the Asur Bhumi. And Dr. A.R. Biswas, the barrister known for judicial jurisdiction, who wrote the history of Bengal, he wrote that Bengal is named after Bangasur, and it was outcast, excluded land from the Arya birth, and it was not a Brahminical, Brahmin religion, and Hindutva was unknown to this area. They rejected Permanent Land Settlement Act, and just after the just after Palasi War, the Chuar rebellion began in the Jungle Mahal, spanning from the Digha sea coast, the Roop Narayan River, east and west Midnapur, Bakura and Purulia, Bardhaman and Birbhum districts, and adjoining Odisha, Chhattisgarh, UP tracts, and Jharkhand and Bihar. And the company, East India Company, used to detain and arrest those rebels who were not hanged, as in Phasi Daga Mart in Salboni near Midnapur, and in Lodha Suli, they used the Suli, the triangular iron pyramid on which the rebel had to sit, and then it would pierce his heart and mind, and he would succumb. 21 Lodha tribals were the first martyrs of India in East India Company. During Mughal and Pathan period, during the Aryan period, our forefathers, the aborigine and indigenous people, remained in darkness, as I choose the darkness to remember our forefathers. And he fought for us. They were never subordinated. They were never enslaved. The caste system enslaved us. And as Baba Sahab Dr. B.R. Ambedkar focused on the single goal of annihilation of caste to free Hindutva of its karma phal, of its sacredness, purity, and racist mode, to make it democrat. And he used to say, when we fight for freedom of the nation, entire nation would stand with us. But when we fight against caste system, and to annihilate the caste, the entire nation stands against you. And those people, the victims of caste system, they support the hegemony. He said, I am in darkness because I am speaking about the darkness which has enveloped the country since the transfer of power and since the Holocaust began on 15 August 1947, with unprecedented violence which continued, with unprecedented displacement which continued, with unprecedented population transfer and demography change and political equation which do continue in free market economy. Baba Sahib said, the freedom of India is compulsory, but without annihilation of caste, it would be, say, it would be slavement under Hindu nation. At the same time, Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, he rejected to join Swadeshi movement, as Bal Gangadhar Tilak declared that Swaraj would be Peshwaraj, and of course it is Peshwaraj, as we have seen in Sanjay Leela Bhansali film Bajirao Mastani. It is of course the Peshwaraj, and the freedom struggle to establish the Peshwaraj or Ram Raj or Manusmriti rule was opposed by Mahatma Jyotiba Phule. And at the same time, in Bengal, the leader of Chandal movement, Guru Chand Thakur, the leader of Matua movement and son of Harichand Thakur, rejected Deshbandhu Chittaranjan Das, who conveyed the message of Gandhi to join the Swadeshi movement, and Guru Chand Thakur answered that you behave untouchability, you practice untouchability, you discriminate us. First, you have to accept us as your brothers and sisters, then we will join the movement of freedom. Dear, assumption has come true and it is Hindu nation without any lesson of caste, and I would focus on any lesson of caste, and then I would go back to Jangal Mahal, and hence I am including this speech of Anand Teltumbde, the national professor who can teach mathematics, physics, chemistry, law, businessman, and who contributed most in digital India and digitalized entire Ambedkarite literature, and he is the grandson-in-law of Baba Saab Dr. Ambedkar.
Weekly. And like that, his public life started. He went back to London to complete his PhD in 20. Meanwhile, he gave a testimony to Southborough Committee in 18 and started attending conferences, etc. But he did not make up his mind really to get into public life at Prologue. It is said that when the Mahat organizers, the Mahat Satyagraha organizer, who was basically Comrade R.B. Morey, that time something like 20, the person in 20s, he was the brain behind. And when he was approached to Baba Saheb Ambedkar, when he came back again from London in 23, so that time Ambedkar, it is said that, it is probably not true, it is said that Ambedkar responded saying that I don't want to indulge into this affairs, I want to be a district judge. Now it doesn't sound plausible that such a person with all kinds of these kind of decorations, two PhDs, etc., would say so. All right, then he comes and founds the Bahishkrit Hitkarani Sabha. Okay? It's to be noted, certain things are notable, that Bahishkrit Hitkarani Sabha, entire Bahishkrit Hitkarani Sabha, the membership was our upper caste. Okay? There were no Dalit. The only executive committee of it, that means there were two things. Bahishkrit Hitkarani Sabha is the parent body, and then there is an executive committee. Executive committee, Ambedkar was chairing it, and Shiv Tarkar, another person, not of a Mahar caste, he was a Chambhar caste. That is also important, because now these identities have researched, and now one needs to differentiate how Ambedkar started off his movement. So he belonged to Chambhar caste. The next two Mahar, something like Chamar, in UP context, etc. So that was the caste. So he became a secretary. He was a secretary, and few of the Mahar then were the members. This was the composition. Then came Mahat Satyagraha, as I said, R.B. Morey, who became Comrade Morey later on, and made a mark in CPN. So he was the person behind organizing Mahat Satyagraha. Although Comrade Morey became communist, they remained in contact and had a mutual respect. So whenever Baba Saheb used to come back to Bombay, they used to meet. Every time they both met and discussed things. So these are certain glimpses as to the relationship between communist and the Ambedkarite, Ambedkar himself. Okay? Then Mahat Satyagraha happens.
Anand has written a book on Mahar.
To start with, if you
to understand, should read the book to understand the Mahar, the Dalit movement, Bahujan movement, and Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and his
something like he was
mission, the annihilation of caste.
He takes the advanced elements of Hindu society enough, then they would come forward to undertake certain reforms in Hindu society. Okay. This part is being used by Hindutva forces today, saying that Ambedkar was not against Hinduism, he really wanted to reform Hinduism. Okay? The Mahat Satyagraha, what was Mahat Satyagraha basically? Mahat Satyagraha was to assert the rights of Dalits to have access to public places. Now, this access was not being demanded or fought for the first time. It existed legally already. There is in Bombay Legislative Council, there was a Bole resolution which actually was passed a couple of years before, which actually granted Dalits right to access all public places. That means public places in temples, tanks, and so on and so forth, public roads and all those. So rights existed, it was a matter of assertion, it was a matter of implementation of those rights. So there was a big depressed classes conference that they organized in Mahad and called Ambedkar to preside over. This is the way it happened. The next day, before concluding the conference, the Hindus attacked. No, these people went to Chaubara tank. there was a tank in Mahad town. So these people went in a procession and exercised their right. They went into the tank and took water and came back. So the orthodox elements, after these people returned, they attacked them, okay, and quite a severe attack. A lot of people actually went there and all those things happened. Now, alright, this conference was attended by the Mahas who had participated in the First World War. There was that area itself, not many people had actually served in British military. And that was the background. All those people were the delegates to the conference. These people were totally enraged and just wanted the Ambedkar not to retaliate. And it is typically described by his biographer that if Ambedkar had said just yes, they would have had it. Unfortunately, for me personally, Ambedkar said no. My book is coming in Mahad and there I said...
It has come.
What?
It is published.
Ambedkar had said yes then. The entire course of Dalit history and entire course of Indian history would have been probably different. Okay? So, this is one thing. Next, this happens in 27 March, the first conference happened. Ambedkar is enraged and then second conference he decides just after 8-9 months in December. And that is the consciously planned conference. The first conference, it is said that was attended by the various figures, 3,000 to 5,000, but next conference there were more than 10,000 people. Because it was a consciously planned Satyagraha conference. It was named as Satyagraha conference. And very conscious planning had been behind. So there were 10,000 people came from far-fetched areas also. It was so decided, it was all planned. So Manusmriti would be burnt. And even the people would
it is Manusmriti Dahan.
Chaubara tank until it is opened.
RSS celebrated Baba Sahib Jayanti.
Question, when would this Satyagraha be withdrawn?
RSS celebrated Samvidhan Divas.
How was it and how would it be?
But it did not celebrate Manusmriti Dahan Divas, and Anand is talking about Mahar Satyagraha, and it connects to Medinipur. The human escape of the human escape non-Aryan, the Bahujan, and their movement, their freedom.
Saying that,
and it is different from postmodern Ambedkarite movement. We have to understand this phenomenon.
It was a Chaudhary tank. It was manipulated, right? In my research, I found that the British collector, who was the collector of district, he actually had prompted the people, okay, to manage this, and the injunction was obtained. This injunction, then all the conference, this becomes a focus point. The entire thing goes off. The Manusmriti, of course, is burnt. Manusmriti is burnt by a person called Sahasrabuddhe Gandhi, and thereafter it is taken over by the Mahar saints. There used to be, I think, sadhus of the Dalits caste. Those days, difficult to imagine, but then thereafter they also participate in burning Manusmriti. This is the notable thing, but their entire proceeding goes on with around this injunction only, whether to carry out Satyagraha or not. The people who gather there are inclined to carry out Satyagraha, whatever that takes. There are attempts, you know, the basic collector comes, and he also wants an wants to address the people. Surprisingly, Baba Sahib Ambedkar gives him praise. He addresses the delegates. Thereafter, it is so decided, people are not satisfied. He threatens that, okay, if you carry on with your resort to offer Satyagraha, you would be actually incurring displeasure of the state. You could be arrested, so you could take action. People give a damn to him and want to go on with Satyagraha. They said that we have come here for that purpose, and we are prepared to go to jail. Ambedkar then says that, okay, this is easy to say so, but let us take the signature. And signature.
I have got the visuals I was looking for.
Everybody would
focus on his letter. I want to make a point. What should be our struggle, and what has been our struggle, for which our forefathers, the rural indigenous aborigin peasantry in India, divided in caste system, were fighting, and how we deviated from the annihilation of caste, and the struggle for freedom, which we have been enslaved.
This kind of background is important. Just after this is over, this is December 27. In January 1928, in the meeting, Ambedkar starts actually talking about conversion, because it becomes totally disillusioned that any reforms in Hindu society is possible in this manner. Right? And he starts talking about conversion, and he starts talking about converting to Islam. He directly says in January 1928, you become Muslims. In my area, that meeting happens, and 20 people become Muslims. They are still there. Okay? Basically, he starts thinking turning toward the political space that was being created, because there is a Morlamanto reforms. Before that, Morlamanto reform in 1909, then the Montague Chancellor reform that was slated. Then in between, there is a Lucknow Pact between Muslim League and Congress. So all these kinds of things were happening on the political horizon, and he looks at the opportunity unfolding. Okay, because all kinds of the contention for share of political power was tenuously rested on the assumption that Hindus, Hindus included Dalits. If Dalits say that we are not a part of Hindus, then entire balance would go bust. So that was the political opportunity he picks up, and he actually gets totally disillusioned about the temple entry, etc. People do not understand. His followers keep on doing satyagraha. Thereafter, Parvati satyagraha, then Nashik satyagraha. All those satyagrahas happened, but Ambedkar is not in that. He tacitly says, okay, you carry on kind. He does not discourage them. But he is not. His mind is not there. So initial kind of statements about conversion, etc., could be construed as a threat to Hindus that we are prepared to do even that, okay? And actually sensitizing them towards what is likely to be the implication in a your political arena. So this when he drives, and thereafter you would find that the Simon Commission and thing there, Simon Commission, the festival Simon Commission, which was actually boycotted by Congress. And on that basis, the Ambedkar gets invitation to the Roundtable Conference in 30, 31, 32. All these things are the sequence to that, right? Now, many of you know, this much probably was not known because it still lies in Marathi. When my book comes, probably it would be opened up to the English world. But otherwise, all these kind of things that I said, are not available to non-Marathi people.
There the book has been published, you can get it online.
Roundtable conference, he demands separate electorate for Dalits. Okay? And he succeeds despite the vehement opposition from Gandhi. When communal award is declared by Ramsay MacDonald, the separate electorates are given for Dalit. Gandhi sets on independent fast and blackmails him into agreeing with, and Poonap Act gets signed. Poonap Act, what it does is separate electorates are given up, and instead of that, far more reserve seats are offered to Dalits. Okay? So that happens. Thereafter in 30s, Ambedkar tries out to, because as it was unfolded, you know, the 1935 Act was to, the Poonap Act gets incorporated in 1935 Acts, and then the provisional assembly elections would happen in 1937. He floats the party in 1936 in the wake of elections, called Independent Labour Party. Okay? From 32 onward, the things were totally clear that the way the politics would be unfolding itself. So there would be something like elections would happen, and electoral politics, meaning the universal franchise would slowly come in, etc. So Ambedkar wants to expand his constituency, starts eyeing to broaden it. Distinctly sees that only concentrating on Dalits or untouchables then is not going to work. And he starts talking about talking about the entire working class. This independent party veritably becomes the first left party in India. Although Communist Party comes into being in 20s, but independent party, you have to acknowledge that communists then either were working clandestinely or as a socialist bloc under Congress cover. Okay? So legally it was difficult for communists to operate. So independent party is the first labor party as such. to have been formed in 30s. This is the first left party, first left party of India. One should acknowledge. And he declares that Brahminism and capitalism were the duo enemy of Dalits. Entire 30s, if you find that he comes very close to the left, to communist, and he tries to extend hands to the communist, but that part we'll see later. Now 35 in between, there is sort of lot many strands of Ambedkar that you have to discern, and probably they do not cover well. Why he talks the entire leftist language? The the Independent Labour Party is again as a kind of replica of Independent Labour Party in London, which was actually the Fabian Party. Its manifesto almost mirrors theirs. It does not have a word caste. You will be surprised that many people ascribe the Ambedkar only work for caste, etc. Independent Labour Party, the first party of Ambedkar, does not have a...
It is very notable.
It's only
Ambedkar did not address caste.
It does not have...
And Labour Party did not mention caste or caste system. And it was not identity-based political party.
Okay?
And later, I agree with Anand, it was the first communist party, first left party in India, which was started up by no one else but Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And hence, I often say that the real communist manifesto of India is the agenda of annihilation of caste, Baba Saheb's mission. It is the real communist manifesto in India. Thus I say.
To imagine India to be the bunch of communities, and they actually maintain that. So they say that, what way I talk to you?
Mind you, Anand Teltumbre is not a public orator. He belongs to academia and he cannot speak fluently like those engaged in politics. He is speaking quite academically, and you have to understand.
Background: when he gets an invitation from Jatpat Todak Mandal, Lahore,
everyone is important, please listen to.
This is the annihilation of caste is nothing but the speech that Ambedkar writes to be delivered in as a presidential speech in that conference. So the organizers want him to send a copy before, so Ambedkar sends it, and they find some problem with the certain paras, and they request that that be deleted. Ambedkar does not agree. As a result, later they cancel the conference. So, annihilation of caste is the undelivered speech in the conference which was never held. Ambedkar publishes it and it creates quite a stir. Now, what is there in this is the background, because this is the context now in which this thing needs to be read. Just before year 35, in Yale, there is a conference, and where Ambedkar declares that although I couldn't help
the freedom struggle by indigenous aborigine rural India.
It's a big problem.
And the aftermath,
all said and done,
because this. People were excluded and made subject to ethnic cleansing with racist apartheid, and the result was the Mahar movement and the emergence of Baba Saheb Dr. Ambedkar and his mission for annihilation of caste.
Start writing this speech. There he explains the rationale for his declaration. He starts off It's very important, and again, his English translation is available on the internet, but in Marathi, the title was Mukti Kon Pathe, which way the deliverance?
Mukti Kon Pathe, the original writer, Kannel Sarkar.
Activist of Ambedkarite movement.
It sounds Bengali. Mukti Kon Pathe. It is Marathi and it is also Bengali, mind you.
School teacher. He explains systematically and why he said so and all that thing. This starts off with atrocities on Dalit. So atrocity on Dalit, he says it's not atrocity but something like anybody can walk in, slap you and get away. Why does it happen? So he reasons out it is because of your weakness. That you do not have a strength of numbers because you are a minority in any village, okay? You do not have the financial strength, that means you do not have money also, and you do not have moral strength. Having lived for hundreds of years as slaves, you have imbibed that slavish mentality, so you do not have moral strength also. Then he contrasts it with Muslims. He said that Muslims also play similarly, demographically similar, because they are never majority anywhere. But nobody would dare to touch them, because they know.
Because I have not to include
Muslims from Kashmir to Kanyakumari.
And hence, this headgear should go.
To support them. And he does not have it. So, clear of all of us that we should actually emulate something like become Musalman or something. Because his diagnosis also leads to how do you overcome this weakness? Simplistically, he says that by merging into some existing religious community. Now, which were the existing religious communities then? Some Muslims and Christians and Sikhs, of course. Christians are never inclined for whatever reason. But Muslims are always talked about. And thereafter Sikhs also came in. Sikhs are never talked about, but he actually afterwards he signed a deal to Amritsar, which remained in and my father-in-law was a part of it. Kind. Okay. So this happens. This is the background in which he writes. So it's a very, very vehement kind of text, and he actually makes it very comprehensive. And as it comes to that, it's very clear at the end he says that as for me, I have decided to go out. I wish you well. Now, how does it start off? It starts off with something like a social reform and political reform, because these questions were hanging in the air, okay? In the upper class or non-Dalit kind of arena, this was a question which hung in the air. There was a national movement which was actually demanding political freedom from colonial rule, and there were the groups which actually hampered upon the social thing. So when the Congress came into being in 85, that time itself this duality happened in Congress. The Congress accommodated for quite some time. The social conference used to happen. Whenever the Congress conference happened, a part of it used to be social conference. So there were distinctly these two things were going parallel. But thereafter, when it came into Pune, the first time Tilak did not allow their pandals to be used, and then drove them out. So this happened. And even those who were on a political side, they never actually relished this idea that anything of this kind should be tried out. Ambedkar cites W.C. Banerjee, who was the president of Allahabad Conference, Congress Conference, saying that how does it matter that our daughters do not go to colleges, schools, or our widows are burnt on this thing. What has it got to do with the political freedom? So such kind of statements, etc., there are plenty of such citations, etc., Ambedkar provides. Then he explains systematically that how social change is important, more important than the political change. How social freedom, so to say, or social reforms are more important than political. He uses these kinds of words, reforms, social reforms and political reforms also. Political reforms meaning something like getting Swaraj or freedom from British rule. So firstly, he explained that point, that how social reforms are more important than political reform, because unless society bears it and actually internalizes it, the political reforms will not be successful. That is what is contention. Now he brings in, it actually frames in a broader framework and make the point. He brings in something like, he initially itself classifies in two camps, two parts. Who are the people who are opposed to social reforms? One is the nationalist stream, those kinds of people, or Congress, who were actually hampering upon political freedom from British. One. Second thing is socialist. Ambedkar, there was no tribe that existed as a socialist, actually they were the communists. But Ambedkar always uses as socialist to them. So they were also opposed, right? So nationalists, I said what their contention was, and but socialists he deals with. They say that, and it still goes on, that if the revolution happens, then automatically all these social problems should be taken care. Okay? Marxists have that, they use a Bayesian superstructure kind of metaphor of Marx, okay? And with this, they still hamper upon that actually if the proletariat revolution happens here, then all these problems should be taken care. Now they do not say, earlier time they used to say almost kind of automatically it would be taken care. Now there is over 7 decades, probably there is an improvement saying that there is nothing like automatism. You may have to work for that. But still, the Bayesian superstructure holds good. So then Ambedkar contends and makes it a broader frame that in history, always political reforms are preceded by the social reforms. And he gives an example of Rome and all kinds of things down to Shivaji. Shivaji's political revolution is preceded by the Bhakti movement, for instance, the social movement in Maharashtra. How apt are these examples, etc., are different point. But this is the way he contends, that the point is, and the valid point perhaps even today, is that based in superstructure kind of metaphor, somebody imagines that without tinkering with social sphere, if somebody imagines that political change can be brought in, it might appear that the political change comes, but it would never last. So that ground needs to be prepared for that. There has to be something like a dialectical relationship. Ambedkar does not use this language, but there is a dialectical relationship between all these kinds of spheres. You do not imagine that things happen automatically. So that meaning could be derived from the entire thing. Then there are certain kinds of he says in relation to this would be important, because he makes many kinds of such points in relation to Marxist. Never uses Marxist as a word or communist as a word. They are all grouped together under socialist. Why I am saying so is that ultimately these are our Dalits belong to the same class, and we'll have to pay attention to what is happening to the other camp. The emancipation of Dalit cannot happen if you are if the
that cellular jail in Port Blair, and he took part later on in independent India. He took part in a lot of social activities in this district.
That is Kharagpur IIT. It replaced the Hizli concentration camp. It is a beautiful campus. Thus you go to IIT Kharagpur, and it is the gate. These are the students, and it is the Hizli concentration camp, the barracks.
The IIT Kharagpur has come a long way since its permanent campus was set up at the historic complex of the Hizli detention camp in August 1951. This is where many freedom fighters were imprisoned and executed during the British Raj.
These were the barracks. These are the barracks. This is the history of, the real history of freedom. Rani Shiromani, she belonged to our Mitra.
The building also served as the headquarters of a bomber command of the United States Air Force during the Second World War. Buildings have now been converted into a museum.
I am Dhruvajyoti Sen. I am chairman of Nehru Museum of Science and Technology. I am looking after this museum here. And here we are displaying the entire history of the national history, as well as the freedom fight which took place in the soil of Midnapur.
The first session started at this building with 10 departments, 42 teachers and 224 students. India's first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru said this at the first convocation of the IIT Kharagpur in 1956. Here in the place of that Hizli detention camp stands the fine monument of India, representing India's urges, India's future in the making. His words are now etched in stone. The institution has now transformed itself into a world-class hub for innovation and applied research. It now has over 10,000 students, about 575 faculty members and more than 2,000 administrative staff, including technical, administrative, project staff and outsourced personnel.
Again, Hizli.
This was an infamous jail building in the sense that this was the only jail building in the entire British Empire where two unarmed detainees were shot dead inside this detention camp. Tarokeshwar Sengupta and Santosh Kumar Mitra. Santosh Kumar Mitra was a classmate of Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. So they were shot dead by the British police. They just fired from this place and then shot dead. Both of them were there on the first floor and on the ground floor. And so that particular incident of martyrdom of two great freedom fighters, that had, started a very new kind of an event and a chain of events in the politics of the British India. And then later on, when the Second World War started, then the Anglo-British group, they decided to convert this Yale building into the base of American Air Force. Incidentally, from 1941 to 1945, till the end of the Second World War, the same detention camp was being used as one of the major hubs of American Air Base in the southern part of Bengal. And as a matter of fact, during the whole of Second World War, the aircrafts, they used to fly from here and then go over the Himalayas and move to China, and from there they used to go to Singapore and also to Japan for bombing. So a large part of the British American air base was located in this place.
It is again Hisli concentration camp part 3. Thanks, YouTube. Thanks, Professor Ajay Rai.
So, this was one of the hangars where, in fact, in this place, a lot of American aircrafts used to be kept, which took direct part in the Second World War. Now, it is the same, building where IIT Kharagpur was started after the independence. The history of IIT Kharagpur, it dates back to 1945. Much before the independence of India, contrary to the general notion that IITs were started after the independence, and this was the thought of post-independence India, this is not true. In fact, it was the British government who had started a commission known as Sarkar Commission. Nalini Ranjan Sarkar, who was the chairman of that commission, and that commission was started in 1945, and they had given the report in 1946 about the higher technical education in India. Now, based on that report only, the higher technical institutes were started in India. The first such institute was started in Kharagpur, which was subsequently named as the Indian Institute of Technology Kharagpur, the first in the chain of now 7 IITs in India.
It is part 4. It is very important. We have to include it.
So these were also an array of prison cells, and the getting news, some of them who were, living and rather, who were not very much cooperative with the British rulers, they used to be kept in these prison cells. And these were, as a matter of fact, the punishment cells. And as you can see that the cells are so small, and the detainees, they were not allowed to go back, to go out. And there was absolutely no chance.
They sacrificed their life.
The locking system arrangement.
And we don't know any one of them.
And
we celebrate independence.
Now, what we have done is that here in these array of cells, we have tried to keep the 200 years of history of freedom movement of India, and especially the contribution of this district, Midnapur district, where IIT Kharagpur is located, in the freedom movement of India. In fact, this is the district which possibly had the maximum contribution in our freedom struggle.
Mind you,
because this was the first district where three consecutive district magistrates, they were shot dead by the Bengal volunteers or by the freedom fighters And they had openly declared that they will not allow any white man to become the district magistrate of this district. So it was in 1931 when Petty was killed, subsequently in 1932 Douglas was killed, and in 1933 Bard was killed. And thereafter we really didn't have any British district magistrate in this district, because they wanted that this district should be freed from the British rule. History of freedom movement, we started from here, because way back in late 18th century, after say 1757, the Black Battle of Plassey, in which the British people, they captured the East India Company, they captured the whole country gradually. So from 1757 onwards, in late 18th century, we had a place which is known as Phashi Dangar Mart. And in that particular Phashi Dangar Mart, they had a lot of...
I mentioned it, in Salbani.
All those, you know, I mean, tribal people, those who were, you know, I mean, revolting against the British rule, they were simply hanged on those mango trees. There was no formal hanging. People were simply tied with the mango trees, and it was a very torturous kind of a death. And that particular, you know, field, it's also known as Phashi Dangar field, marked, that is the field of, you know, I mean, hanging tragedies, and it is still there in a place called Gorbeta in this district. So then we had, you know, Raja Ram Mohan Roy, who was the first man who had really started the, you know, social reformation, and his major contribution was going against Shoti, and then to start an era of reasoning and rationality in the minds of the Indian population. So he was a great social reformer. He was the one who understood that it is important to have English education.
Raja Ram Mohan Roy.
It was he who understood the importance of science education, and it was he who understood the essence of the religious reformation. Of modern India, and one of the first persons along with Raja Ram Mohan Roy who started the Renaissance in India. So he had started the widow marriage, and then he was the first man to start girls' education even in those days. So he was also known as Doyar Sagar, that is, he used to donate all that
Sagar
he earned throughout his life. And he really wanted to take the country out of the darkness, and especially in the realm of the ladies' emancipation in the country. Sudhiram was the first martyr from Midnapur district, and he was hanged along with Prabhudeo Chaki.
Sudhiram Bose.
You know, I mean, very committed revolutionary. They wanted to kill the district magistrate of Bengal Presidency. His name was Kingsford. Incidentally, they couldn't kill him, rather some others were killed in the whole process. But then Khudiram was caught, and then he was hanged. Rudolf Rabindranath Tagore, who was the man who had really made us the entire country. He had started the initial Swadeshi movement during the early years of 20th century, from 1905, when the partition of Bengal took place. Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, he protested against it, and he started Rakhi Bandhan, and then finally, you know, the Quit India, the partition, anti-partition movement was started throughout the country. And Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, the first Nobel laureate from not only India, but first Nobel laureate from Asia, in 1913 he received the Nobel Prize. So he was the man who had also one of the major personalities in the freedom movement of India.
I would be attaching details and documentation of the history of Kharagpur IIT with this video.
To start a lot of revolutionary activities started in various parts of Punjab, Bengal, Maharashtra, and also in some places of Tamil Nadu. So,
Anushilan Samiti, Yugantar Samiti, and Gupta Samiti. All these revolutionary organs have their base in Midnapur and Jangalmar.
They thought that the only way to drive the British rulers out of this country was by not by the peaceful non-cooperation movement, but by at the same time by armed rebellion, which many of them they started in various parts of the country.
Easily barracks. It is very important to understand the indigenous history of the struggle for freedom.
Then came the most important event, one of the most important events in the history of freedom struggle, that was firing at Higley detention camp. So in Higley detention camp, as we said earlier, these two freedom fighters, Santosh Kumar Mitra and Tarakeshwar Sengupta, they were shot dead by the British police. They were all unarmed detainees, yet they were shot dead. And that had created a lot of furor. There has been a lot of commissions, both in England and also in India. And because after the Jallianwalabagh incidents, this was the only incident in the whole British Empire where the unarmed detainees were shot dead by the police. Now, this particular event of Higley massacre had created a lot of, stares throughout the country. Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, he wrote a poem, Prosno, which is a very famous poem in Bengali. And starting with, Rabindranath Tagore, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, Jawaharlal Nehru, and even later on, Mahatma Gandhi, all of them they visited this particular place, and then they wanted that the British must mend their ways, and they have to take into consideration that the country belongs to the Indians and they are only the rulers. Tribal community, that is the Koles, Bees, Santals, and all these rebellions, tribals, They really took part in a lot of rebellions throughout this country, and they are very poor.
Aboriginal
people, and it was these people who had a very massive contribution in the freedom movement of India. So here in this part, in the southern and western part of Bengal, in Bihar, in Jharkhand, in northern part of Orissa, comprising of this whole area, there have been Koli uprising, Santal uprising, Munda uprising, and there have been a lot of fight with the British people. With their traditional arrows and bows, the tribal people, they used to fight with the most sophisticated arms of the British rulers.
Now, let us go to the poem by Tagore himself, Prashna. It is the voice of Rabindranath Tagore.
আমি যে দেখেছি গোপন হিংসা কপট রাত্রি ছায়ে
হেরেছে
অপরাধে বিচারের বাণী নীরবে
বিচারের বাণী নীরবে
তরুণ বালক উন্মাদ হয়ে ছুটে কি যন্ত্রণায় মরেছে পাথরে নিষ্ফল মাথা কুটে কণ্ঠ আমার রুদ্ধ আছে
It is Agnes the Hizli killing. It is also relevant today. This is the question. Let us see a Bratati.
Bukir bhitor prey hilo na. Premer jonno dukkho elo. Brikkho dile, patro dile,
shakhi. It was Bratati. Now, this would be something different.
Bhagavan.
Prashna Rabindranath Tagore. We are here from Rabindranath Tagore.
Daya him shamshare. Tara bole gelo khoma koro shobe. Bole gelo bhalo basho. Antar bhitore ekte shishe nasho. Boroniyo tara. Shoroniyo tara.
This is the question remains unanswered even today.
Barth namaskare. আমি যে দেখেছি কপট হিংসা কপট রাত্রি ছায় হেরেছে নিঃসহায় আমি যে দেখেছি প্রতিকারহীন শক্তির অপরাধে বিচারের বাণী নীরবে নিভৃতে কাঁদে আমি যে দেখিনি তরুণ বালক উন্মাদ হয়ে ছুটে কি যন্ত্রণায় মরেছে পাথরে নিষ্ফল মাথা কুটে কণ্ঠ আমার রুদ্ধ আজিকে বাঁশি সঙ্গীত হারা অমাবস্যার কারা লুপ্ত করেছে আমার ভুবন দুঃস্বপ্নের তলে তাই তো তোমায় শুধাই অশ্রু চলে চাহারা তোমার পিসাইছে বায়ু মুখাইছে তব আলো
জঙ্গল মহল সাম অফ দ্য ক্লিপিংস আই উড সি আই উড শো ইউ ইট ইজ দ্য জঙ্গল মহল Now, Jangal Mahal, what is Jangal Mahal? We have to show you the landscape. It is the Jangal Mahal in West Bengal.
Bhagavan, tumi
It is the landscape, extension of the rainforest mangroves. It is something different. We are the latest news is it is another Maoist regrouping in Jangal Mahal of West Bengal. They are branded as Maoist nowadays.
మళ్ళీ ఆతరహాలోనే ఉద్యమాన్ని ఉధృతం చేసేందుకు వ్యూహాత్మకంగా అడుగులు వేస్తున్నారని మమతా సర్కారును నిఘా వర్గాలు హెచ్చరిస్తున్నాయి.
మావోయిస్ట్ అగ్రనేత కిషన్జీ ఎన్కౌంటర్ తర్వాత ఏడాదిగా ప్రశాంతంగా ఉన్న బెంగాల్లోని జంగల్ మహల్ లో మళ్లీ అలజడి మొదలవుతోంది. రాష్ట్రంలో తృణమూల్ సర్కారు అధికారంలోకి వచ్చాక ఆ ప్రాంతంలో ప్రాబల్యం కోల్పోయిన మావోయిస్టులు తిరిగి పుంజుకుంటున్నారని ఇంటెలిజెన్స్ వర్గాలు హెచ్చరిస్తున్నాయి. వరుస ఎదుర్కాల్పుల ఘటనలకు వేదిక నిలిచే పశ్చిమ మిడ్నాపూర్, బంకురా, పురులియా జిల్లాల్లో బలం తగ్గిన మావోయిస్టులు తిరిగి ఉద్యమాన్ని బలోపేతం చేసే దిశగా చిన్న చిన్న బృందాలుగా పార్టీ శ్రేణులను పెంచుకుంటున్నారని దట్టమైన అడవులు, అభివృద్ధి కానరాని గిరిజన ప్రాంతాలు గతంలో మావోయిస్టులకు మంచి పట్టిన ప్రాంతం కావడం వల్లే జంగల్ మహల్ లో మళ్లీ బలం పెంచుకునేందుకు మావోయిస్టులు
What does people of Jangal Mahal want? It was the movement in Jangal Mahal.
আমাদের সমস্তে উন্নয়নের কাজ করা কি অপরাধ? আমরা বেতাড়ি ব্লকের সিমুলতাল অঞ্চলে বিভিন্ন গ্রামের মানুষ। আমাদের গ্রামগুলি খুবই পিছিয়ে পড়া এবং সব দিকে উন্নয়ন।
This is the freedom.
আমরা এলাকার জন্য বহু দিন ধরে পঞ্চায়েত সমিতির সদস্য এবং ব্লকের সরকারি অফিসারদের কাছে আবেদন জানিয়েছিলাম। কিন্তু উন্নয়নের বদলে আমরা পেলাম পুলিশের সংকট। আমাদের অনেকে নানা রকম মিথ্যা মামলায় জেল খাটালো। এমনকি সিপিএম নেতারা মিথ্যা কথা বলে ও জোর করে আমাদের দিয়ে মাওবাদী পার্টির বিরুদ্ধে গোষ্ঠী মানানোর চেষ্টাও করেছিল। হত্যাধারা কদমিনা ও বেলতলি ক্যাম্প থেকে পুলিশ দীর্ঘদিন ধরে আমাদের জীবনে অশান্তি করলো। পাশে ঝাড়খণ্ড রাজ্যের মাটিয়াবান্দি ও তাঁতিলিয়াতে পুলিশের ঘাঁটি কখনো
রিপ্রেশন কন্টিনিউস
রাজ্যের পুলিশ
The ruler itches, but the repression continues because it is a military state.
2008 সালে আমরা কোন গ্রাম 15 গ্রামের জনগণ মিলে 3 মাস কাজ করে সুনন্দর বাঁধ সংস্কার করলাম এবং 6 কিমি দীর্ঘ কেনেল সংস্কার করলাম। প্রায় 10,000 লোক কাজ করে 800 বিঘা জমিতে সেচের ব্যবস্থা ঠিক করে নিলাম। এই কাজের জন্য আমরা নিজেরা উদ্যোগ নিয়ে 1,00,000 টাকা জমা করলাম। প্রায় 15 বছর ধরে এই বাঁধ ও কেনেলের সংস্কার হয়নি। বিশেষ করে সাওড়াকোচা গ্রামে প্রতি বছর নালা কেটে যেত, আমরা নিজেরা সামান্য মেরামত করলে টিকত না। 2008 বাঁধ ও কেনেল সংস্কারের সময় আমরা সেখানে 600 মিটার কংক্রিটের পাকা দেওয়াল বানালাম। ব্লক থেকে বাঁধ সংস্কারের জন্য 3 লাখ টাকা বরাদ্দ হয়েছিল, তার মধ্যে ঠিকাদার প্রথমে 80,000 টাকা ব্লকে ঘুষ দিল, বাকি 2,20,000 টাকা নিয়ে কিছু সিমেন্ট বালি আনালো এবং বিভিন্ন খরচ দেখালো। আমরা নিজেরা উদ্যোগ না নিলে বাঁধ ও ক্যানেল সংস্কারের কাজ কিছুতেই হতো না। আমরা মোট যে কাজ করলাম তার মাঝে সিপিএম সরকারের সহায়তা ছিল মাত্র 5%। কাজের সময়টায় প্রতিদিন পুলিশ আসত, কে কাজ করাচ্ছে বলে আমাদের ধমকি দিত।
And now we know this Jangal Mahal, the Chow dance, for Chow dance. This is projected and showcased. It is projected as growth, development and celebration of life, and it is not there. And now, another shade of culture, Mehul Radda.
আমরা আজ ঝাড়গ্রামে জলসায় মহুলের রাস্তায় ইন্দ্রাণী মামাতোকে পেয়েছি আমার সাথে। আর সকাল থেকে ভেবেছিলাম ইন্দ্রাণীকে আর দেবাশিস দণ্ড একদম কোণে বসে আছে।
This is the cultural team representing Jangal Mahal. Instruments. This is the cultural set. And it is about Nehru Stadium, we should not miss it. It is situated in Kharagpur IIT, which we visited. Thank you. That is the Nehru Museum of Science and Technology, IIT Kharagpur. No, it has not got the yes, it is the mechanical devices displayed in IIT Kharagpur. It is very useful for civil mechanical engineering. It is inside the Nehru Stadium, the development of mechanical engineering, these are the devices. The latest museum is not available, I think. I don't know whether it is videographed or not. This video is showing only mechanical engineering models. No. Let us should get. You can get all these videos, and it is not so relevant. I was trying for the Nehru's speech. I got the Nehru speech earlier, but I am not getting it today. If I get it is Nehru, but not in Kharagpur. Okay, we should skip. I want to end this video with the Mahar movement, as we wanted to show you the original indigenous aborigine movement, and then the Ambedkar, Dr. Ambedkar Mahar movement, and the video of Anand Teltumbde. And now it is about Mahar Satyagraha.
This conference that has been called to inaugurate an era of equality in India has no parallel in Indian history. I can only compare this to a meeting held in France in 1789 that ushered the French Revolution. Our conference is the beginning of such a social revolution in India. We are here to declare a war. Our goal is not only the abolition of untouchability, but a war against the caste system itself. We will not be immortalized by drinking water from the tank, but this our action will prove that we are also human beings. We must establish the principle that status in India shall not be determined by birth, but by merit alone. We must rearrange Indian society on the principles of a casteless, classless society. We must adopt the principle that all men are born equal and die equal.
That is Baba Sahib.
Of the ancient Hindu scriptures that abound in inequality. Brothers and sisters, religion and slavery are not compatible. By birth, I condemn outright the doctrines of the Mansuri. It is a symbol not of religion, but of inequality, cruelty, and injustice. I know a revolution than the Mansuri, which has been the cause of untold sufferings for the generations, be publicly burned.
ृतभक्तमेव
वा घाटायं वै सृष्टोऽसौ रामयाच स्वयं भुवा